Hello everybody, Jose Rodriguez here. It is a cold day, but at least it's sunny. The heater is on, so you might hear a little background noise. I got the laundry going in the back. This is real life, folks. I just got a comment a couple of days ago, not even, from a viewer who had about 7 or 8 questions that I thought, you know what, these questions deserve a video. Well, I lost the comment. I don't even know where it went. I don't even know from where it was from. I saw it on my video and I didn't really get a chance to save it because I was about to jump into bed and go to sleep. But anyway, I went ahead and put together some questions that maybe would be asked by someone thinking about getting into this hobby. What hobby is that? Of course, photo printing at home. So I went ahead and created a list for me. I made 10 questions and a little bonus one at the end. So please stick around. This is not going to be a short video, but it's going to be a video that you will want to watch in detail because I'm going to address as if I was the one thinking about getting into this. So I'm going to address all of the questions I would have had at the time. And that was about 15 years ago. And believe me, there was no one out there to help me. So I made every mistake in the book. And it took me quite a while to grasp the skills that need to be learned in order to allow you to consistently create prints that match your monitor. All right, so let's begin. The first question people ask is, I want to print my photos. Why should I? Well, if you enjoy seeing things instantly, more or less, rather than have to wait for days, then you might be a good candidate, or at least you might have a good reason for you to get into this and start printing at home. Why? Instant gratification, that's one answer. And of course, you have full control. What happens when you send your images to the lab to be printed, whether it is online or whether it is down the corner and you give them your little memory card? Well, you may not get back what you think you are expecting to get back, especially if you were viewing these images in your monitor. You may not get what you wish. So the only way to achieve that, either by trial or error, or after you master all the necessary skills, you will be able to create predictable prints that match what you see on your monitor. And that's the whole goal here. You need to be able to edit and then print and produce prints that match what you just spent maybe half an hour editing. So let's begin with the next question. What printer should I buy? Well, that's like me telling you what camera should you buy? What computer system should you buy? We'll start a war if I start doing that. I cannot tell you what printer you should buy. You should ask yourself, what is it that I want to accomplish? Do I want to make large wall prints? That would require a big, large format printer, Canon or Epson. They're both good, and both brands are capable of producing incredibly good results. You don't need prints that big. Well, then you don't need a large format printer, okay? You will need a smaller printer. What do you mean by smaller printer? Well, 24-inch capacity, that means wide. That's still too big for you. Then how about a 17-inch capacity printer? And that brings into play a couple of models, one from Epson and one from Canon. What if you just need 13-inch max capacity? Well, that opens up a whole slew of different models from Canon as well as Epson, and even other manufacturers out there that I would really not recommend because Canon and Epson are pretty much the industry standard for photographic print production at home. Not maybe commercially, but at home. So that's something you need to think. What about smaller? I don't need even 13-inch capacity. Well, the only thing that's available out there are your commonly all-in-one type printers. Those are printers that have stacked on top a scanner unit and other functionality that's more office-oriented. The ink sets that you get with those printers are not really tailored for photo printing. They're more tailored for document printing. Maybe you have a bit of graphics, you need bright colors, you need nice strong black. So usually they will come with a set of colored dye inks, that's your yellow, magenta, cyan, and then you will have maybe a cartridge of pigment black ink, and that's good for text, but it's really not good for glossy prints. You cannot print glossy on these printers because they're going to utilize that matte black to accent whatever the compositing of yellow, magenta, cyan could not accomplish as far as your deep black tones. So that's something that is up to you. You need to spend some time, watch a lot of videos, and then come up with a maximum width capacity you will ever need, and then make your choice. Then watch videos about the models that you see. Again, this, you're going to be looking at price, you're going to be looking at number of cartridges involved, you're going to look at cost of operation, that sort of thing. Don't make that decision hastily. Take your time. Don't buy a printer just because the sale is on. Take your time. Those sales will come back. Believe me, they come back all the time. It's like auto dealers. They make you believe that it's only this weekend. You better buy that car this weekend. No. It's pretty much every weekend. So don't worry about the sales going away. They will come back. Just make sure that when you do purchase that printer, you purchase the one that will work best for what you need, what you want in your situation at home, wherever it is that you set that up. Color management. I've heard about that. What the heck is that? Well, it is a series of processes that allow you to then match pretty much what the camera produces, what you have edited on your monitor, and then what you print. So again, it involves many aspects. It could be as simple as simply letting the driver control color. You just let the automation take over, or you take over. When you take over from the automated systems that the driver includes, then you better know what you're doing. And the only way that I can tell you to kind of get into that side of color management, again, watch a lot of videos and study a lot, learn the process. Where can you do that? Right here, folks, okay? Okay, so now I have my printer. What do I do first? Well, you're going to open it up, of course. You're going to look at it, make sure that everything looks normal. There hasn't been any shipping damage, okay, that you can detect with your eyes. You're going to then choose a place, and it would make more sense, unless it's a very lightweight small printer. Say you chose an all-in-one, then you can pretty much set it up anywhere you want. But make sure that you are not tempted to use the Wi-Fi functionality of some of these printers. Plug it into your computer, please. That way you have the fastest pathway for the data that you are sending. That data would be image data. Let's drink some coffee. I have 13 printers. 10 of them are photo printers, and the other three are just other printers that I have. This one right behind me right now, you cannot see it, thankfully, because it's not being used at the moment. Anyway, so you're going to set it up someplace that's going to be semi-permanent. Some printers really cannot be moved once you set them up. You have to perform certain operations before you move them to a new location. There are ways to get around that, but again, we're not going to get into that at this moment. So you're going to set it up. You're going to open up your instruction. Usually you will be given a large single sheet that opens up into fours, and there it will tell you step by step what you need to do to set it up, whether it's on a Macintosh or on a PC running on Windows. So go through the steps. Some of them are slightly different than others. Canon printers require that you install a printhead at some point. So make sure that you do that extremely carefully and you read the instructions before you begin to assume how things are supposed to be done. Don't assume anything. Read the instructions. Once you get your printer operating, it has been charged with ink. And again, that differs in the model. Then you're going to install the driver. Folks that use Macintosh, please, Mac OS, don't plug in the printer to your computer. Okay? Do not do that. Go to Canon or Epson driver support online. Download the latest driver for your printer. Not the combo package, but the individual driver. When you go on site, either on Canon or driver support, it will ID your OS, your operating system, and it will then recommend the correct latest driver for you. Okay, do not just plug it in, because you're going to end up with the Air driver, and that is just a generic driver with no features whatsoever that are pertinent to your particular model that you chose to buy. So don't do that. On Windows, that doesn't happen. If you just plug it in, nothing's going to happen. You still have to download the driver. So you download the driver, you double click it, do whatever it is you need to do. In Mac, is it a little different? Once you do that, it will then tell you to install it, and then it will say on Windows to go ahead and plug in your printer, power it on. Once you do that, it will then automatically proceed with the driver installation. It will identify your printer, and then you will get a notice that everything is hunky-dory. Basically, it is installed. You'll be able to see it in your devices and printers. Okay, so that is how you do that. In fact, at that point, you can go to right-click, driver preferences, and you can send a test print. Basically, it's just going to be a series of text, a little bit of color, just to see if you are actually truly communicating with your printer. All right, so now the computer is recognizing your printer. So what do you do next? Well, you have to determine whether that ink charge that took place during the installation process has indeed primed fully, 100%, that print head. So the only way to know that is by running a nozzle check. So you will run your nozzle check in your driver. You're going to go to your driver maintenance tab or whatever it is called and look for your nozzle check icon. You're going to click on that and run it. It differs in Canon and it differs in Epson. So you will run it. That will tell you whether any of the nozzles are not firing. If they are not firing, do not proceed any further. Run a cleaning cycle, because that means that the printhead maybe did not fully charge with ink, okay? So that is something imperative that you need to do. Do not proceed to printing images. If you do that and your printhead is not fully charged, you could damage it if you are running a Canon printhead, because those are thermal type printheads. We will not get into that. If you want to learn about that, look at my other videos in this channel. There's almost 1,200 at this point. So next thing you do, once you have verified that your nozzle check is perfect, is to complete a head alignment procedure. Now, in some cases, some printers do it automatically. You basically insert however many sheets of paper they ask you to insert and then run it. In some cases, it is a manual process. You will require your eyeballs to do this and maybe a little magnifying glass to look at the patches that are printed and to choose the correct one or the one that looks best. Now, what paper should you use? You should use the paper they provided you. Do not use that paper for your own personal prints. That paper is for you to run these preliminary tests. Why should I run my ProLuster paper on these silly non-photographic tests? Because ProLuster and glossy and anything that is not plain paper will not wick away the ink and blur the results. The sensors inside the printer require a sharp rendition of what it is trying to print so that it can determine if it is correct or not correct. So using the provided paper, you will still have like one sheet left for your initial print. And we'll discuss what that is next. So you have verified that the nozzle check is perfect. You have verified that the head alignment is correct. Now you can proceed to print, but not your images. Do not do that. If you're itching to do that, just use some anti-itch cream and, you know, kill that itch. Do not print anything that belongs to you yet. You're going to download the evaluation print V002 from my Facebook group. If you're not a member, make sure you join, because it is the best group about photo printing, bar none, out there. We are over 2,000 intelligent members that will help you with anything that you can come up with. They are there to help, including myself. But sometimes they are a lot smarter than I am. So you download the image. If you do not do Facebook, oh, too bad. No, not really. I will put a link on the description from which you will be able to download this huge file. It is not huge physically. It is huge by file size, about 50 megs. It is a TIFF file, and it does not have any color space, don't worry what that is at this point. You're going to open it in Photoshop, Lightroom, Qimage, whatever you're using, and then you're just going to print it. Do not alter it. Regardless of what it looks like on your monitor, do not alter it. Send it to the printer. If it's a Canon, choose photo printing, the paper type that you're going to print on, quality high, and of course the paper size. If it is an Epson printer, you just installed it, so it's going to be defaulted to Epson sRGB for color mode. You're going to, again, just choose the paper, quality, and size, and print. The results, if the printer is working correctly, should be excellent. Okay? Make sure that you evaluate this print on a daylight source illumination, whether it is a window, whether it is an incandescent light. It has to be daylight balance. You're going to look at it, you're going to know if something is off. Okay, so that's how you will determine if your printer is printing correctly on its own with no help from anyone or anything. If that is the case, if you get a great result from that image, then you are ready to go. Well, not quite yet. Oh boy, I just found out that, yeah, my monitor needs calibrating. You know how I know? Because when I took that print that looked perfect to me, and I put it next to my display, displaying the same image, it didn't match. Yeah, so now you got to consider buying a monitor calibrating piece of hardware. You can't do it with your eyes. Your eyes will fool you 100% of the time, unless you're an Android, okay? You cannot do it with your human eyes. So you need an unbiased piece of hardware to be able to pull this calibration job off. Now, I recommend, simply because of my experience has been so good with these items, X-Ray, Color Monkey Photo, which is now gone, replaced by the i1 Studio, which is basically the same unit. This is a spectrophotometer that will not only calibrate your monitor and also allow you to create paper profiles down the road. Now, if you really want to get crazy, my shoulder is killing me. I pulled a muscle the other day. Here's the i1 Pro 2, which is $1,500. You don't have to go that high. This is about $350 right now if you can find the Color Monkey Photo. They're selling about $350 because they're no longer available. The i1 Studio is about $500, what this used to be back in the day. OMG, I didn't realize I had to get into that. Yeah, sorry. Unless your monitor, for some magical reason, is perfectly calibrated for photography, not just for viewing like they do at the big box stores. Those monitors are set as bright as they can be set, as contrasty as they can be set, and the saturation is up so that you think, oh my gosh, boy, is this monitor great. No, it's actually not so great. Okay, that is not the correct settings. You should be looking at that image and it should match the output of that printer. The image will probably look overly bright, will probably look overly contrasty, as well as probably the wrong color, not to mention saturation being too high. So all of these things need to be brought down to a standard. There I go again, a standard. And that standard is set by the International Color Consortium, which is the ICC. They're the ones that make those profiles that we love to use to really get and squeeze the most out of our printers. So yeah, sorry guys and gals. Folks, you need to calibrate your monitor. Otherwise, why would you bother editing anything? Anything you edit will not really reflect in print because your monitor is off anyway. It's not correct. So you need to get that monitor down to a correct level. And you should be able to actually calibrate two monitors if you have a dual system and have them match. Why do you want to do that? Well, let me give you a scenario. You're making some cookies and the recipe says to set your oven at 350. But when you set it at 350, according to the dial, it's really 400 and your cookies burn every single time. So you say, well, maybe I should put it at 200. Why would you want to do that? See, why would you want to do that? You want a dial that reflects what the actual internal temperature of the oven is at any time and point. That's what we are doing. We're calibrating our monitor so that whatever I feed it, image-wise, will be displayed correctly. If the color is 122, 250, 117, it should be displayed as 122, 250, and 117. That's it. It should not be displayed as any other value. That way, if I want to make a minute change, and I expect that little change to be reflected in print from my brand new printer, then I have to make sure that what I am seeing is being displayed correctly. Otherwise, just don't even try. Just close up shop and go upstairs and watch TV. Don't even worry about it. You're not going to ever get a match. Oh, but I can do some afterthought adjustments. I can create a layer. Well, you know what? A lot of really silly people do that, but it's not the way to approach this. If you have to adjust your image one stop so that it prints correctly, sorry, you're doing this wrong, okay? You really are doing this wrong. If you have to darken the image one stop to make it look correctly, you really are doing this wrong. If you have to change the color so that it looks kind of yellowish so that it will print neutral, you're doing this wrong. Okay, you should get what you see is what you get. What your monitor displays is what you will see in print. Now, it's not going to match the look. Oh, did I do that again? The look of your monitor, because the monitor, of course, is backlit and prints are front lit. You are seeing a reflected version of what the ink has done to that paper on the monitor. It is transmitted light through the rear. So you're going to see always it's going to look with a little bit more pop. But we're looking at color matching, okay? We're looking at consistent matching of brightness, consistent matching of tonalities, and of course, linear tonality, meaning that a given gray, for instance, will not change hue from the darkest step by step by step by step all the way to the brightest. It will still remain a neutral gray. It will not change hue. It will not become cooler or warmer and then back to some other, you know. No, it will not do that. It will stay constantly. So that is why your monitor needs to be calibrated and calibrated not only for color, for contrast, for brightness, and for linearity so that it is constant from dark all the way to white. Okay, papers. Oh my gosh. There are not millions. I was going to say millions, but really not millions, but probably a couple of hundred different papers out there. And you might think, well, I got to try one of each. Oh, that would be the biggest mistake you will ever make. Here's what I suggest you do at the beginning. And I don't know what your goal is in your photographic endeavors, whether it is to produce just snapshots for your family or gallery level prints. There are papers for both of those approaches, okay, made by many different manufacturers of paper or sellers of papers, and I'll tell you why I said that a little later. So when you open up that box with the printer inside, they gave you a little 5-sheet pack. One would be for the nozzle check, two probably for the head alignment, and then you would have like 3 sheets of that. You used one for the standard image, and then you got 2 to play with your own images. That's been your first exposure to paper. Don't switch to another paper. Go ahead and buy a box of 20 or 50 or 100 sheets of that same paper. Learn to use that paper. Master that paper. Learn everything about the look, the images that work with it, the images that do not work with it. Not all images of a certain theme will work uniformly or universally, I should say, with every single paper. No, that's not the case. That will not happen. Some images work better with certain papers. Just the look will actually help the theme of your image, okay? Will actually add to the look, to the impact. Baby pictures on glossy paper, that really doesn't work very well. A shot of a snow-capped mountain, kind of bluish, everything is kind of cold, bluish type theme. Yeah, glossy and metallic works really great with that. A portrait of a baby sleeping on a blanket. You know how they do these portraits nowadays? They actually maneuver the babies into all these weird positions. A warm, rough texture watercolor paper will work beautifully. Okay, cold looking paper will not work. So again, image has to be matched with the paper type, but master that first paper first. Okay, so just get yourself a box and play with it. Make sure that your monitor has been calibrated and make sure that you did that certification of the printer. Because then if you don't get a match, that is something pertaining to your image. Maybe the image's color space is not matching what the printer is expecting to see. So again, you're not dealing with perfect images. Your images are not going to be perfect like that evaluation image that you can download. That's a perfect image that has been engineered to be perfect. Yours are not. Mine are not. I'm not just saying yours, also mine, right? Okay, so that is it. Get those three things done and you are on the road to actually enjoying your photo printing adventure. We don't want to create any kind of pain, any kind of drama, any kind of, you know, negative vibes that will drive you away from this. We want the progress from beginning to you being able to print your images to be smooth and without any hurdles as you go down that road. Again, so papers, just stick with one and then later on learn about other papers within that particular brand at this point. Guess what? Even though there are hundreds of paper types, they're only produced by a handful of paper mills. So there's going to be a lot of almost identical papers being sold under different names by different sellers. So again, don't go hog wild, crazy, buying every kind of paper you can buy. You will go nuts, you'll be lost, and you will not know what the heck is going on. Okay, too many variables. You want to reduce the variables to as few as possible. Once you master Pro Luster from Canon or Presentation Matte from Epson, then go ahead and go to the other companies and download their sampler packs. You will pay about $20 for two sheets each, in most cases, of a batch of papers that they sell. And then you can go ahead and explore. Print the same image and see how it reacts to the different paper surfaces and how it reacts to the different paper tonalities. So that will give you an idea. You know, I don't like the way this paper looks for these images, but I do like the way that paper looks on these other types of images. And just write that down. I like this paper. I hate the other one. No, then that's out. You're not going to consider that. By buying the sampler packs, you will save yourself a ton of money from having to buy full loads of paper, say 12 of them, and then you end up with a box of paper you really do not like. It doesn't really get along well with your images or your printer for that matter. It could be. So again, paper is again like cars. How can I tell you what car to buy? How can I tell you what camera to buy? How can I tell you what printer to buy? You get what I mean. There's too many choices. Wait, you say I need ICC profiles. What was that I heard you say earlier? ICC profiles. Well, our first attempt to print was done through the driver. The driver has built-in controls that tells the printer how to mix the available colors that it has to reproduce whatever values you are sending it. And these were from that standard image, that evaluation image. And it did a good job. I guarantee you it did. And maybe by itself, it might be good enough. Yeah, if you're using a Canon printer or an Epson printer and you're only printing with Canon papers and Epson papers that are available as a drop-down menu item, then you can probably print simply letting the driver control color for the time being. Here's what might happen. All of a sudden, you have an image that contains colors that are a little bit almost out of gamut. And by out of gamut, I mean that the driver is not going to be able to reproduce them very accurately because they just kind of fall outside. It's like sound that we cannot hear, but some animal can. They have a higher gamut or ability to hear sounds beyond the human ability. So some colors exist beyond the ability of a printer to reproduce them. But you can surely as can be reproduce them in your monitor. And you think you're going to get what you see. No, you won't. You will not get what you see because those colors that you have added by increasing saturation, whatever the case, are no longer in the gamut that the printer can reproduce. In other words, they are unreproducible by the printer. Now, you can adjust this. You can help this. You can help the printer out as much as you can by using a custom ICC profile. That is the same thing the printer is attempting to do on its own, but a little bit more advanced. It's a little bit beyond what the printer can do on its own. So rather than let the printer do that job for you, you're going to tell the printer, hey, listen, buddy, take a break. So you're going to turn off color management in the printer. You're going to turn off color matching in the Canon printer. Epson is color management, I believe, and Canon is color matching. You're going to turn those functionalities to off or none because you don't want the driver to then have anything to do with color. Think of it as a director of a big symphony orchestra. He's going to orchestrate the whole process for you for that particular paper, that particular printer, and that particular inkset. And that's it. That's what an ICC profile does. It will then attempt to recreate as close as possible, as long as your monitor is calibrated. Okay? That's imperative. That is, you cannot even begin to think, even get away with using an ICC profile if your monitor is not perfectly calibrated. Oh, I wanted to do this. Perfectly calibrated. I love that. No, I don't. I really hate when other people do that. Anyway, let's continue. So yeah, the ICC profile will actually create the best possible rendition for you of that image. Again, as long as the image being sent to it represents the actual colors, assuming your monitor is correctly calibrated. See, I go keep going back to that. And that is imperative. I love that word. And your printer has already been certified, you see. So we have those two items already taken care of. The ICC profile will now orchestrate the mixing of the colors to an extent that the printer driver really cannot do on its own. So the results should be a little bit better. Most people who don't have the visual acuity to be able to see slight, almost imperceptible differences in color will probably say, ah, it's the same. But there are people that actually can tell the difference. So for those of you who want to extract the most out of your printer's ability, you need to go the ICC route. You need to turn off color management in the driver and then allow Photoshop or Lightroom or Qimage or whatever you're using. Those are my three go-to editing applications. I don't use anything else. So don't ask me about anything else. I am a dummy when it comes to other applications. Those are my three applications. That will produce the best possible print that your printer is capable of producing. It will squeeze the last drop of quality out of that printer. The driver, maybe 98% of the quality. With an ICC profile, you'll squeeze the last drop of quality out of that printer. All right. Why should I stay with OEM inks? Because they are the best. Simple. They are the best. Why do they cost so much money? You know why? I'll tell you why. I'm glad you guys have stuck this long. The raw products, whether it is the dyes or the pigments, first you start with a clear base. And it has to be the correct viscosity for that particular printhead to be able to handle. Think about something thick like honey trying to be passed through a syringe needle. It's very difficult. And then you have something as, you know, low viscosity like water. You can squirt it right out with little pressure. The viscosity of this clear base media has to be correct. It has to be a baseline. When you add dyes, it's going to change the viscosity a little bit. So that has to be readjusted. The dyes that are used with the Pro 100, for instance, are synthetic, very expensive dyes, okay? Epson, the same thing, very expensive dyes. Pigments, oh gosh, the pigments that are used are the best pigments in the world, okay? And they cost a ton of money. Oh, BS, you might say. Third-party companies should be able to do the same thing. You know what? Yes, they can. To a certain extent, sometimes they do not have access to these proprietary products. Yeah, only available to certain companies. So the third-party lab that produces inks for, you know, 1,000 resellers just simply doesn't have access to that. Or even if he did, he would have to pay a ton of money for those raw products and then pass that cost to you, and you would not be very happy because you want to print at a tenth the price of OEM. That's what most people want to do. And it's just not going to happen. You're just not going to get the quality of the raw products that make up those inks, the pigments and the dyes. Okay? You're going to get something that says it's pigment, and it may be actually 70% dye and 30% pigment. Yeah. That's what happens. And you just don't know who is pulling the fast one on you when you buy these inks. Now, if you buy from reputable companies that you could find out who the source of inks is, we won't discuss the companies that produce inks for everyone else. But, you know, you can then have a little bit more confidence on those particular resellers. I have a few that are my favorites. Again, but if you want the best results, I'm sorry to tell you right here and then that if you switch over to third party of unknown sources, your colors are going to change. All that work that you did, down the toilet, folks, because you're going to have to start all over again. Your profiles are not going to work because the color rendition, the spectral qualities, if you will, of those inks will not match. And match is the magic word here. Those 9 colors on an Epson printer, those 12 colors on a Pro 1 have been matched to each other. They get along beautifully. They can be orchestrated to produce super accurate results. When you buy the equivalent 12 colors from some Chinese source on eBay, because it's so cheap, you just can't pass it up, you're not going to get that match. They get a yellow from this, a magenta from that, a blue from this, a black from that. They're not going to be matched to each other. Okay? You're going to be pulling the last few hairs out of your head. This is from past years, my friends. So, yeah, don't do that. If you really, really must, and you're not selling your work, then yes, consider a few of the choices that I'm going to be discussing later, maybe on the live stream, not here in this video, because I don't want to name companies at this point. But there are several companies that produce excellent third-party inks that prove themselves color-wise, matching-wise, longevity. They cannot come up with the OEM longevity. Sorry. They just simply will not last you as long as a print made with the real deal. Okay? You have to do certain things to your prints so that they will then last longer. Certain protective steps that you take. Again, these are not necessarily needed for prints made with OEM. They always help. They always add to their even great longevity more. But you know what? I'm going to be 70 this summer. Stay tuned for that. We're going to have a little party. And what? If I live 20 more years like my dad did? What's the point? I can make my prints last way beyond that. So even if they faint at, say, 15 years, I'll just print me a new one. If we're still using the same technology in 15 years, who knows? So I'm not too worried about the longevity side. What I am worried about is matching what I see in my monitor, whether I'm using OEM or whether I am using a good quality third-party ink. And I stress that, good, reliable quality third-party inks. Okay, we probably talked too much in that subject, but it's a huge one. You can do a whole show 3-4 hours long on just that subject, and people will disagree, agree, and maybe sit on the fence and teeter-totter, you know. So it's a big one. You know, OEM, forget that. I want to print cheap. I want to have my cake and eat it too. Well, you can't. You just cannot. I wish I had some cake right now. With this coffee. I got a banana that I got to eat. My wife told me, you better eat that banana today. Got to do what the boss says. So, yeah, you cannot have your cake and eat it too. Like I said, you're going to lose somewhere. When you pay a sixth of the price, an eighth of the price, a tenth of the price per print, because you're using a third-party source, you lose something. You're going to lose something, definitely. In most cases, if it's a well-matched inkset and you got a good custom-made profile just for you, and by the way, I do that as a service, look into my description for the links to my profiling service. That will get you to a point where your prints are going to pretty much match, that means close, but no cigar, close, match OEM. So where do you lose longevity, like I discussed earlier? Your prints are going to fade probably 10 times faster, okay? That's the God honest truth. And so if you don't want that, if you cannot afford that, you're selling some work to people, you better not be selling them something that's going to fade in a year. It better last at least 10 years, and you better protect that somehow, whether it is applying a spray or whatever the case will be. You better either tell them that you will replace their print for free if it fades, or simply use OEM. And again, you need to tell them that this is an inkjet print and it will succumb at some point, just like lab prints do. All of my old wet prints are fading, and they are in boxes protected from the atmosphere. They fade regardless, okay, through other reasons, but they fade. Nothing is going to ever not fade. Look at the Washington Library on Congress. Everything that needs to be protected is protected in some ridiculous, you know, UV glass, bulletproof glass, and very low lighting of a specific wavelength. Yeah, they know that things will fade. So if you want to maintain the highest level of longevity, then you have no choice. You have to choose original inks in this case, and just add that extra cost to your price point when you sell your products. All right, that was 9 topics. I'm going to give you a little bonus here. When you get into printing, you're going to be exposed to all sorts of different terminology and lingo. Learn it. Learn it. Don't use silly terms. When you ask questions in printing forums, in Epson groups, Canon groups, learn the lingo. That way people will not treat you like a newbie. People will not treat you like you're inferior to them. Unfortunately, a lot of these groups are kind of monopolized by certain number of members, senior members. Did I do that again? Senior members that think they know it all. Well, some of them do, but you know, they act like know-it-alls. So come across like you know what you're talking about. Don't say test print when you really mean a nozzle check. Okay? There's so many. I'm going to do a video on just that. Silly terms that people use when they should be using the correct term. And that way, the people that are trying to help you will actually respect you. And they'll kind of, they will not look at you like prey, okay, that they can just pounce on and ridicule. Everybody has printing problems. Every one of us has gone to these forums to ask for help. So if you come across like you know what you're talking about, okay, then people are more likely to help you. And you will end up with quicker answers to your questions. When you ask for help, make sure you provide them with the important information and not irrelevant information. If your car is making a noise, does the color of it matter? Whether it's a blue car, a red car, or a white car? You see what I mean? You need to actually describe your problem. You need to give the person who is attempting to help you, in this case, let's just say it's me, the printer model, the make, your settings, where you're editing from, what paper you are using. Are you refilling? And this happens all the time to me. People are telling me something and I realize, wait a minute, this guy is refilling. Because this would not happen if he did not refill. You see what I mean? So you need to give every pertinent bit of information. Not that the printer is located in my living room. That has nothing to do with a problem unless your living room is 110 degrees. You know. That would be important if that was the case. So keep that in mind, and that will allow you, the newbie, the beginner in this hobby, and we want to keep you. We don't want you to flee. after just a couple of weeks. We want to keep you in this wonderful, rewarding, and gosh, I just cannot imagine ever not doing this. So again, the best thing that can happen is for you to have a successful trip to this road of color printing. When you see your first beautiful print emerging, and this happens all the time, I get this all the time on my Facebook group. People are so giddy that they take shots of their prints and post them on my Facebook group and tell me how thrilled they are to be able to get this type of quality out of a prosumer printer thanks to this group or this channel, if that's the case. And of course, that keeps me going. Otherwise, there's no reason for me to keep going hammering the same topics on a day-to-day basis. It gets old after a while. But anyway, I hope this video, if you take the time to actually view it, sit down and view sections of it if you don't have all that time, because it's going to be long. And then apply this to your situation, whether you are just thinking about getting into it or you made that mistake to buy that printer on a whim and now it's in a box and you're scared to death to set it up, or you have set it up prematurely and now you don't know what to do. Okay, so watch this video. This should be a sticky in all of the channels, in all of the, you know, forums as well. I think that would help out a lot of people, prevent a lot of problems, and guide you down the correct road. I could not say that enough. Thank you so much again. I hope you enjoyed this. Again, make sure you join my Facebook group. Make sure you join the channel if you haven't already done so. And if you're here visiting, make sure you subscribe. Click on that notification bell so that you get notified not only our live streams on Saturday evening at 6 p.m. U.S. Eastern Time. Pretty soon it'll be standard time again, I believe, or daylight savings. I don't even know. Always 6 p.m. anyway. And I occasionally do a impromptu live stream once in a while, midweek during the afternoon. For those who are in weird time zones, maybe they can catch a live stream when you are not able to do it during the scheduled time. So that is it for now. Don't forget, of course, like I said, subscribe, share, and like. Share information with others. Tell them about this channel so that others come into our little realm here and enjoy each other's company. Happy printing, everybody. Bye-bye.